This formula is great, but unfortunately, you know, we don't know really what it would look like, or is it even possible to generalize it to multiple dimensions? So this is something that I worked on with Peter and Andrew, so I'm very happy to present a multi-asset, multi-dimensional generalization of the Carr-Madan spanning formula, which involves very interesting but new a lot more complex mathematics, and I'll just give maybe a bit of a quick overview. So. All right, so let me get started here. So do I get here? Okay, I will do this. Okay, so as a general summary, so a great deal of mathematics is about breaking down complex structures into simpler ones, and then applying the principle that the whole is the sum of its parts. And an example I really like is a Taylor series, which break down a complex function into a sum of simpler power functions. And the Carr-Madan spanning formula does just that, which is breaking down any single asset European option payoff into a sum of cash, forward contracts, and then the options. And therefore, the consequence of that is that the price of this exotic European could be, you know, for example, the law contract is a very successful application, but you know, it could be any kind of payoff, you know, you can express mathematically. And so you can decompose that as cash plus forward contracts plus a bunch of calls and puts. And therefore the price of a European payoff is model free as long as you know the call and put prices.
That, I have a very stupid question, my apologies. Yeah, no worries. Does the derivative price, the column of your pricing, does it have to be a form you get payoff simply as a formula of S of capital T, or could it, right, let's say, could it involve, this could be a silly question, earlier values of S, or going strictly a general function of S of capital T being the expiration date?
So that's a great question, and it turns out that in the Carr-Madan formula, it's only a European option that only depends on terminal asset price.
Yeah. Won't you make, but Lacan suggests that, I would assume, right? Law contract is linked to the VIX with that.
Yeah, but law contract is very linked to the VIX, you know, later on. But the law contract itself, which is the log of the stock price, is only depending on one. So it's a single variable function that depends on the stock price.
So there's an intuition reason why you could never have such a formula if the payoff was a function of
several things. Yeah. So you can. We just did that, but you know, for a long time we felt that it was, you know, just, I mean, you know, not something that we thought was possible. So I'll show how that's done. But the original formula, which is already a fantastic result, is how you can essentially break down any exotic function, you know, function of, you know, the stock price, as a sum of simpler components, and therefore the price, the fair price, the arbitrage price of that exotic payoff would be given by the prices of these known securities. And I'm using like sigma here, but actually this is a continuous sum, so I should have used integral, but just to simplify this, it's just a stylized fact here. So most successful application of the formula, the law contract, I'll show what's being. The talk is organized with a discussion of the spanning formula in connection with related results. And then I show how it's generalized to two classes of multi-asset European options, dispersion options, and also European options with homogeneous payoffs, arbitrary payoffs of multi-asset options. For example, a best of. And the result can be further generalized, but it's ongoing research. Now, the main mathematical tool for breaking down the multi-asset option as a sum of simpler components, these simple components are going to be options on baskets. So we could say a portfolio, let's say, you know, 50-50 baskets on Apple and Microsoft or something like that. Anyway, so the tool to do that is known as the radon transform, which is also used actually in medical imaging and other engineering applications to reconstruct, for example, the slice of a patient's brain. So I'll explain a little bit more what's going on with that transform. It's closely related to the multidimensional Fourier transform. Okay, and you know, we looked not just at, you know, general theory, but we actually tested it with relevant applications and found some post-form solutions. So I'll give some introduction facts and then talk about the spanning formula, the Carr-Madan spanning formula, and then talk about generalization to multi-asset options and give some main application results and you know, conclusion and some appendices. If we have extra time, I can go a little bit more into the math. So let's get started. I want to start with the VIX, and that's the most visible application of the Carr-Madan formula, and talk also a little bit. I mentioned dispersion options, so I want to show what it looks like. It's an option that actually trades, and then some notations that I'll be using for other talk. Okay, so. So this is a picture that I took from the VIX white paper. This is a 2019 version I found online. So if you're familiar with the VIX, it should be a familiar formula. The VIX is the volatility index, very successful measure of implied volatility. So the a level of volatility on option markets. And it's an aggregate measure that aggregates option prices for a given maturity. To then get subsumed into a square of volatility, and so the index is defined as the square root of that calculation. And we can ignore the residual part here, which is important. But the really interesting thing with this formula is that the VIX is a number, so it could be like what is now probably 30 or something like that. So it would be the 30% squared is equal to, and then we get actually a bunch of option prices. These are the Q of KIs. So KI is the strike price. So we look at all strike prices. So think about the S&P, and then you're looking at 1 month maturity, and then you have all kinds of options with strikes from 200 to 6,000 or something like that. And then the formula is a structure where you look at all the strikes. If the strike is less than the forward, more or less, the forward price of the S&P, then you look at a put option. So these are all like out of the money options. And if a strike is greater than the forward price, then you take a call option. And so you make a sum of all these option prices. And somehow it's not obvious that you're going to end up with a volatility number. And so that's kind of a bit of a magical. In the early days, the old VIX was calculated, I guess, using the closest option, closest to the money. And then they would have the implied volatility. So they would use, I guess, an inversion of the Black-Scholes formula and all that. This formula is somehow model-free in the sense that you don't need to assume Black-Scholes model or anything like this in order to derive an implied volatility number. And so that is what's so remarkable already about it. So if you add up call and out of any call and put option prices with the right quantities, then you end up with a square volatility number. The quantities are also pretty simple. So you have, you know, a strike step with delta of KI, which is, you know, the next strike minus the previous strike divided by two. And then you divide by the square of a strike. We can ignore the forward factor here. Interest rate is close to zero. And so it's a very simple calculation that can be done very fast. And again, there's some marvel in realizing that, you know, by adding up these option prices with the right weights, you end up with a meaningful volatility number. So how is that even possible? So the right-hand side is the sum of option prices, the left-hand side square of volatility. So, you know, I'm giving you know, steps a little bit fast here, but, you know, we start with Ito's lemma. And so consequence of that, if you take expectations, is that you can show that the square volatility is given by this formula here, which takes the expectation of a log of the terminal stock price ST divided by the current price at zero. And this is known as the log contract payoff. And the expectation is the price of the log contract. And so the price of a log contract is the square of it. And the log contract is something that doesn't trade, but it's intuitively, it's very simple. Instead of being a forward contract on the dollar value of the S&P, it's a forward contract on the return, the annualized return on the S&P. But it's not just any return, it's the continuously compounded return. So the payoff that you get is, let's say the S&P goes up 20% continuously compounded, then the payoff would be 0.2, so 20 cents. If the S&P goes down 20%, you get minus 20 cents. And so that's how the log contract works. This contract was introduced in 1990 by Neuberger and has inspired a lot of literature, including Peter's own research on variant swaps and so on. So, so certainly a contract that doesn't trade, but it sort of trades in the form of variant swaps you could sell markets. So the amazing thing is that even though the log contract does not trade, you can replicate the payoff using a portfolio of vanilla calls and puts. And the portfolio is going to be you know, a bunch of puts. So the payoff for put is K minus ST plus, okay, the maximum of K, the strike price, and ST plus. You integrate on all strike prices between zero and the current stock price of the underlying asset. And you have a weight of DK over K square. And so you have a continuous portfolio of puts, and then you have a continuous portfolio of all possible calls that are out of the money. Again, weighted by DK over K square. And then you have you know, something else. And the payoff then of a log contract is replicated by this this portfolio. So so that's the important step. And that is the most successful application, again, of a Carr-Madan spanning formula, which is more general, but works pretty well for the log contract. So that way, the log contract can be replicated or hedged. And it's not very far from the VIX formula that's up there, because if you discretize those integrals, you get, you know, finite sums with weights that instead of dk over k square, you get delta k over k square. And so there you get your, there's a typo here, but there's no q here. But anyway, so you get the payoff of a put for the sum for, actually I said ki being less than k zero, and then a bunch of cold payoffs here. So that's the connection between VIX and Carr-Madan. And so I'm going to explain Carr-Madan to a general version in more detail soon. Another thing in my introduction I want to mention is dispersion options. So these are some of the most sophisticated kind of options that are trading, specifically between the hedge fund and an investment bank. So it's a you know, sample term sheet here, but adapted from a real term sheet from a real transaction. And the way that it works is that the payoff of this dispersion option, so you get a bunch of stocks, so five stocks in that transaction. They each have a weight of 20%. And the payoff you get is the absolute return on each stock minus, I guess, the return of the basket, which we can sort of ignore simplicity. And so that, what that means really is that if the stocks are all dispersed, you get a high payout because it's the absolute deviation that matters, not, you know, the it's not a relative plus or minus deviation that counts. So it's not an average performance of a basket. It's really the sum, the weighted sum of absolute performances of each of the stocks. And then it's a call option on that dispersion metric. So you subtract a strike, maybe 5% from the absolute dispersion level. And then you get to the max of zero in that, that difference. So it's a play on not just, you know, dispersion, but also correlation. And the less correlation actually there is in between these various stocks, and the more dispersed the payout will be. And so it's a very interesting product for a lot of banks, because most banks that sell structured products, they're short correlation, because most of these products are
products that increase in value when correlation goes up, but the bank is on the other side, so they lose money when the correlation goes up. This product, on the other hand, is by construction short correlation, meaning that it will increase in value when correlation goes down. So the banks can hedge some of their correlation exposure by entering into these transactions. And on the other hand, the hedge fund could take maybe advantage of favorable market price of correlation to make money out of these transactions. So one of the most sophisticated, it's so actually sometimes little known that some people were not very familiar are just thinking, oh, you just made this up. Well, no, actually, these transactions exist. It's not super frequent, but these are sophisticated high-end transactions that go on the equity derivatives market, OTC market. And notations that I'll be using throughout the presentation. So all these functions are connected. I'll start with a round function, T plus. It's the max of zero and T, a real number T. And the payoff, the graph of this function is zero when T is negative, and otherwise it returns T. So it's a positive part of T, round function. And you can see that it's a building block for a call option type of payoff. So if T is the difference between a stock price and a strike price, then that would be your option payoff. And then if you differentiate this RAM function against T, then you get zero to the left and one to the right, because derivative of T against T is one. And so what you get is something that's known as the step function, which is essentially telling you it's like a truth function. If T is positive, you get one, and otherwise get zero. And this is also called Heaviside step function. So I denote that function H of T. So they are related, and also it's a building block for a binary or digital option that would pay a dollar if the stock is greater than the strike price and zero otherwise. And then something that's not a real function, but is often called a function anyways, the Dirac's delta function, very much used in physics and other applications. So that is again the derivative of the Heaviside step function. So because the step function is constant to the left and to the right of the origin, then it's zero everywhere. That's the red to right here. However, there's a big jump from zero to one. And so you just artificially or theoretically define a value of infinity for that function just at the origin. And so that's why it's not a real function, because its value is zero everywhere except at the origin where it's infinity, which is not a number. But it's a generalized function, and so conceptually it works. And so you get this kind of zero everywhere, and then a big arrow at most infinity at the origin. So I denote that small delta. Okay, so let's move on here. So let me talk more about the Carr-Madan spending formula, a very important key result from the 1998. So the general version of a Carr-Madan formula is that any European option an exotic option, not a vanilla call or put, anything you can think of in terms of payoffs, any payoff function is then statically replicated with a continuum of vanilla options. So the replication portfolio is that it's made of a certain quantity of cash, a certain quantity of forward contracts on the stock or the asset, and then a bunch of calls and puts that would be a continuous portfolio. So it's for all the possible strikes out of the money for the puts and all the possible strikes out of the money for the calls. You add these calls and puts, and the quantity is the second derivative of the payoff function. So it's an integral and sum on the strike prices. And so you have a continuum of calls and puts, and quantities are F second, second derivative of the payoff function. And so notations, as T terminal price, F of X is that option payoff. So it could be the log contract, if F of X is log of X, you get the log contract. S0 would be any price. So typically actually you use the current underlying price, spot price. MNK is notation of first working class clockwise. So remarkable formula. And so the question is, it's pretty simple. Again, a major implication, this is all payoff. So you know, it's a very strong kind of arbitrage enforced equality. And a consequence is that if you want to price that exotic option f of st with payoff f of st to the left, you can just get that from cash flow value as itself. Forward contracts are easy to price, and then calls and puts, if you have enough information from option markets, let's say it's S&P option markets, then you can know the price. It's enforced by arbitrage. So it's not like you need it's model free and arbitrage enforced. Kind of pricing. So what's the proof for this formula? The original proof from the Carr-Madan paper, let's say that the stock price is, the split actually is zero for EU. So we actually do only spanning with calls. And we want to prove that the simpler version of Carr-Madan, which is written here. And so we only have one single integral. We're trying to replicate the exotic payoff just with calls. And so we want to prove that this equality is true. And in the original proof, they use the sifting property of Dirac's delta function. And so we start with saying that f, the function f, is essentially the integral of f times the delta function. So remember, the delta function is zero everywhere. So essentially, we get zero, except when the argument is itself zero, so at the origin. So if st is equal to k, then the delta function gets activated. And so you recover f of k, which is equal to st, and therefore you get f of s. It's kind of a tautological thing, but it's called the sifting property. Then you integrate by parts. And so that integral is then going to become f prime of k times the Heaviside step function, which is one if st is greater than k and zero otherwise. And then the bracket is just equal to f of zero. And then you integrate by parts again, and then you get a second term, which is f prime of zero times st plus, and then you get f second of k times the payoff. So if you integrate the Heaviside step function, it goes, we go from Dirac and then we go to Heaviside and then we integrate, we recover a RAM function. So that's what we are getting here. And so we get, we prove that way the simpler version of Carr-Madan. Of course, this can be easily generalized to more general formula where you have an arbitrary split level at zero. Another proof that doesn't require Dirac delta functions, some people, think of it, but doesn't really exist. I mean, it's properly defined mathematically. It's part of a theory of distributions and so on, but it requires a little bit more advanced theory than standard calculus, let's say. So you don't actually need the Dirac delta function. So in other approaches, we start from the right-hand side and we want to, we define the right-hand side as this expression here. And then we notice that for k greater than, we integrate over k. If k is greater than st, actually the call payoff is zero. And if k is less than st, then the payoff is simply st minus k. So actually I can rewrite this integral. We thought that it's an integral from zero to infinity, but actually it's an integral from zero to st when the RAM function is not zero. And then the RAM function is just, equal to the argument in that range for k. And so the right hand side is actually this kind of quality here, and we integrate by parts. And after we do all calculations, so the first time we integrate by part, we recover an integral of f prime, which become f of st minus f of zero. And a lot of things are canceling, and in the end, we recover that the right hand side is equal to the left hand side of the Carr-Madan formula. So another way of proving the Carr-Madan result. The proof that I like best, and I think there is maybe another paper, I don't know if it got into, probably got published somewhere, but I can't remember where. So turns out that all of this, you may have noticed, is very similar, familiar, because it looks like Taylor series. And it turns out that this is a formula I didn't really know from my old days of studying calculus. So I had never seen, you know, Taylor series with remainder in integral form, but that's, you know, that exists. And so it's a first order Taylor series. And in that case, it's just a regular expansion, f of a plus f prime of a times x minus a, plus, and then the remainder is expressed as exact in integral form. And that's this integral from a to x of the second derivative of f of t, and then x minus t dt. So actually already very close to the Carr-Madan. So we take x equal st, a equals zero, t equal k. And so we can rewrite this as more familiar form. Not exactly Carr-Madan yet, but now it looks a lot more familiar. And then we can rewrite this integral just doing the reverse trick of what I did before, which is, okay, well, instead of integrating from zero to st, I can integrate from zero to infinity and just do a cutoff with a ramp function and take st minus k plus instead of st minus k. And then I'm done. So and so I think this is a really interesting way of looking at it because it shows how the Carr-Madan formula is actually connected to something very fundamental, which is Taylor series. A very nice way of looking at it. Fundamental formula. There are some connections with other famous results in finance that always covered extensively in engineering programs and financial math programs, but they are usually covered. So a very important theory that came from the 1950s is the arrow de Vreux. So arrow de Vreux, I have to change the languages in the middle. Really the framework that we kind of all use as a starting point for these arbitrage kind of theory. So they start with finite state complete market economy. So essentially we have a bunch of securities that are primitive securities. And then we have a matrix, and then each column corresponds to a stock, a bond, you know, things like that. And then in every future state of the economy, we know the value of stock, bond for it. So we have a bull market, bear market, state, all kinds of things. So the theory is general. There is no prescription on what the states of the economy would be. The only thing is they are finite. And there's another assumption, which is it's complete, meaning that essentially more or less have the same number of states of nature, of states of the economy and assets. And so in this framework, they show that state price securities exist. So they are known as arrow de Vreux state price securities. And these securities are special securities that pay exactly $1 in, let's say, the bull market, but not the bear market, things like that. So a dollar exactly in the particular state of the economy and zero otherwise. So they're kind of indicative functions of the part, which state of the economy we're in. So these usually don't exist as primitive securities. They are securities that can be essentially attained, created as by combining the primitive securities in correct quantities in the portfolio. And so the important result is that any state contingent asset with a payoff vector F, so that would be our, let's say our exotic option, can be replicated with a portfolio of primitive securities. This theory is a little bit more general than just options because it's really about bonds and stocks and other, any kind of payoff vector you can think of. So it doesn't have to be connected to a particular stock or underlying asset. And then the result is that the portfolio quantities to replicate that that payoff vector is given by the inverse of the primitive security matrix, the A inverse, times the payoff vector. And so assuming that it's invertible, so there are a few conditions, but if it is invertible, then that's what it is. And then the next question that economists looked into is, that's for finite state economy, but we don't necessarily know that the economy is a finite state. Maybe there is an infinite number of states in the economy. And so what happens then? So an early paper that looked into a discrete case is by Bule in 1972. And that would be a countably infinite state economy and essentially generalize the result and find the same kind of result. The really interesting extension of this theory is continuous state economy, where we're looking at the stock market. There is a whole continuum of prices that the stocks can take, at least approximately. And so that's a richer kind of model. It's a much harder theory to study, but essentially that's the one that we may want to care about. Another connected result that's very close to Carr-Madan, and some people will say they're equivalent, they're not exactly equivalent, but they are very, very close, is the Breeden and Hitzenberg in 1978. And what they looked at is a one asset continuous state economy augmented with call options. So they are looking at a single asset, let's say stock, and then they consider all possible call options on that stock. And that sort of follows up, I didn't mention it, but there is an early Ross paper that essentially extended our Gobreau case with this kind of setup. But he didn't necessarily get the formulas that Breeden Hitzenberg got. So in this kind of continuous space, continuous state economy setup, then the state price securities, remember they pay exactly a dollar and an omega state of the economy and otherwise zero. But the in continuous space it doesn't make sense. A dollar is just a single point. This has probability zero, so it doesn't really work. So instead, what you get is Dirac delta function. So that's a more theoretical type of security that pays zero, except it pays infinity. Exactly when the stock price has t is equal to a certain value. But anyway, it can be shown that an implication that Breeden and Hitzenberg didn't look at, but essentially some implication of that setup is that the Aro de Breu state prices also exist as direct delta functions. But the really interesting thing is that their prices can be computed with call prices. And specifically, the prices of these Aro de Breu securities is the second derivative of the call price against the stock. And the price, so this is a loose notation, not rigorous. Formally, probabilists will just yell at you for writing something like this because it's formally called a zero. But what I meant here is the density of ST is equal to K. And so this created the whole thing of implied distributions. This is a very important, major paper, probably thousands, if not tens of thousands of citations, so really inspired a lot of offers. And so, you can essentially differentiate the call prices against the strike price, and you get essentially recover the density of the underlying asset you're looking at. And generally, the price of any state contingent asset with payout function F can be computed with call prices, so that's where we see the connection with Carr-Madan, which is the price expectation of the payoff to the left-hand side is equal to the payoff function f of k times the density, which is c second of k, the second derivative of call prices. It's not exactly the same, right? Because in Carr-Madan we have f second times the call payoff, right? And in Breeden Hitzenberg, we get F times the second derivative of the call payoff, C second. So we are connected because if you do integration by parts, you will recover. But Breeden and Hitzenberg are looking only at prices. And what's really important with Carr-Madan is that it's about payoff first. And prices is an implication of Carr-Madan, whereas this is more looking just at prices. Anyway, so another assumption I'm making for that is that the prices I'm looking at are forward prices. So I'm not looking at time value of money as a simplification. Okay, and then Carr-Madan came 20 years after Breeden and Hitzenberg, and essentially they're saying that any European option with payoff function F is statically replicated with a continuum of any options. And the quantity is F of second, and so I already explained how the composition is. And so we extended the theory actually to non-vanilla replicant options, and that would be the first generalization. I won't spend a lot of time on it. But essentially, we said, okay, well, Carr-Madan say we can replicate any exotic payoff with call and puts. What if we wanted, you know, we have a bunch of other types of options. Maybe they are straddles, maybe they are strangles, maybe they're anything you want. And can we still replicate the exotic option? And the answer is yes. You know, we've got a portfolio of cash, underlying assets, report contracts, and then quantities of those. So now we generalize, we just don't have calls and puts as replicants. We have some kernel G that has also a strike price as parameter. So again, think about straddles or strangles or butterflies. And then we can still replicate the payoff, and this puts it in a nice framework of integral equations theory, because trying to find the appropriate quantity phi in order to replicate the payoff f is an integral equation type of problem. And so we're trying to solve for an entire function phi of k, which is the quantity of that particular option with strike price k. And so it's a more general way of looking at it. So there is a well-established theory from 100 years ago. And so then the answer to that is that the quantities of these replicant options you should hold is going to be given by the inverse of the integral operator induced by the particular replicant kernels. There are technical details here, but essentially you can do that maybe with spectral decomposition. There are all kinds of techniques. Sometimes you get post-Fulham solution. And so you would get, so for example, if you try to replicate with straddles, which is the sum of a call and put of the same strike, then actually the quantity is not f second as in Carr-Madan, it's f second divided by two. Kind of intuitive that you get twice as much with a call and put together. And so this is not like a gratuitous sort of theoretical exercise that, you know, because actually option markets now, you can trade packages. And so SIBO and a bunch of our electronic trading venues will let you trade straddles and butterflies directly. And it may be actually better for risk management or any kind of other purpose to trade the straddles directly rather than individually the calls and the puts as specified by the Carr-Madan endpoint. You still have an infinity of them in theory, and so you still need to discretize, but you would essentially get similar results. So Carr-Madan generalization, number one, still single asset, but we go a more general type of option strategies you can use for application. So I'm getting now, after this maybe long introduction to the really exciting generalizations we obtained for multi-asset options. So two papers, one that was actually published shortly after Peter's and Tammy's death. So it was a feature article of Quantity Finance in March of this year. And and also a paper that I published, a follow-up paper in Applied Mathematical Finance that was published in June, I think, as sole author. So we have now generalization to multiple assets. So I won't go through the Carr-Madan formula we just discussed, but the problem we're looking at is now we have a payoff function of several underlying assets, or you could say also it would be the same math, but maybe not as well interpretable. You could even think of, if you have a path dependent option, your payoff depends on a bunch of observations of a single underlying asset. But for all kinds of good reasons, we try to think more about this as a exotic payoff on several underlying assets and assets. And then again, you know, we want some cash and forward contracts on the assets, but we want also a sum of call payoffs. Now, we cannot do that on just single asset calls because we would be trying to replicate something complex and nonlinear over several dimensions by just single dimensional payoff. So we have to give up something, and what we give up is okay, well, we're going to select the simplest instruments we can find that are multi-asset that trade on markets, and these would be vanilla basket call payoffs that essentially pay the average performance of a bunch of securities, the same underlying assets, minus some strike plus. So usually these XIs are returns rather than dollar values, but the map is extensible to any kind of definition of other underlying asset performance. And so you get the max of zero and then this portfolio performance portfolio return until maturity.
So it's calls on all possible weighted averages of return.
Right. So right. Yeah, absolutely. So in we do not integrate on the strike. So the strike is fixed for a number of reasons. You know, and there may be other ways of redefining this problem. The way that we did it is we fixed the strike. We span not on the strikes, but on the weights of the basket. So, you know, any number of ways you can essentially do an average of the returns of the assets together, including positive and negative weightings. So you end up with, you know, baskets that, let's say it could be a 50-50 basket on Apple and Microsoft, but it could also be 75 and 25. It could also be minus 25 and 125, you know, all kinds of possible combinations, all possible weights, and we span, meaning we integrate over all possible weights over the rail line for all these assets.
And this will descend in the one asset version to their formula.
Yes.
You're averaging over all possible weights, and that's over the K.
It will, but there is some, we would have to adapt. It's possible, but essentially in one dimension, we would have to do a little rewriting, but it would be equivalent. I've checked that.
Okay, thank you.
Yes, question.
Yeah, so that's a hell of a calculation, right? N-dimensional continuous strikes.
Right.
I'm kind of imagining, you know, rather than like assuming a correlation structure and reducing the dimensionality of it somehow.
Right. It is, yeah, but if it's two dimensions, then, you know, you would have instead, you know, I mean, Carr-Madan is all the possible strikes, it's easier to visualize. In two dimensions, instead of doing all the possible strikes, you do all possible weights, but it would be a 2D kind of integration. So it would be a double integral instead of a single integral as a Carr-Madan. So, but yeah, in terms of practicality, these basket payoffs are less liquid, and you wouldn't be able to do all these possible weights easily. So there are some limitations, but in terms of the implication is still that if we get an identity like this, then we get a nearly model-free pricing of something that could be a best-of option, could be all kinds of exotic payoffs on these underlying assets, just based on a proper model that you're happy with to price vanilla basket coal. So if you're happy with your vanilla basket coal model, then by arbitrage in principle, your exotic payoff should be consistent. So you should actually use only one model to price these multi-asset European option. And as long as this model correctly prices any kind of weighted basket coal, then you should have, the price. You should be able to use the same model to correctly price the multi-asset option, which is totally an intuitive, and actually it goes against practice, because as I was in industry, for every type of different kind, almost every possible payoff, it would be a different model or some street adjustments, all kinds of things that would take into account things that the Black and Scholes model cannot really take into account, even in multiple dimension extension.
I mean, it's funny, since you're averaging over or summing over all the waves, you wonder, this seems to have a different exposure to volatility skew than the Carr-Madan, where they actually are going across different strikes. You see what I mean?
Right. I'm not entirely, so again, this is payoff more than
but
yeah, once you price it, then I think it would be equivalent, because there is a, if you fix, instead of fixing the strike, we could vary the strike and fix one weight or something like that. So
yeah,
there would be some.
It's just that
when you have multiple assets, you have only a single strike. You don't have multiple strikes. So we have to just integrate on something else.
Sure.
Question, yes. Or no, I thought you were, yeah.
It's a very naive question, maybe because of lack of some finance background. So what is the main technical problem or issue that just adding some integral of the strikes? So we have the integral of the weights plus the strikes. So why could we also
additionally integrate over the strike. And so there are more mathematical motivations for fixing the strike in this case and only integrating over the weights, because essentially we have n variables to the left and we want to have n variable integration variables to the right. And we already have n basket weights. If we integrated one further time with the strike prices, we would need to add a constraint so that we remain in, there's some parity of dimension of, the degrees of freedom to the left and degrees of freedom to the right. So there is some more, but it is possible to reformulate this problem by also integrating on the strike you would just need to add a constraint in your integration, and so that could actually make the math harder to calculate. So that's the problem we're trying to solve. And so here it's a lot less obvious, you know, Carr-Madan, okay, you know, just differentiate F twice. But you know, this is a multi-asset payoff, so it's not like there's only one second derivative. It's absolutely not obvious how you're going to find or recover the quantities of these variable set codes. So after, you know, intense research and so on, I was very happy that I got into a solution. So I kind of already talked about, you know, theoretical benefits. You can essentially have arbitrage with a single model used for a basket calls, practical. You can have approximate static hedges as a result. It can help you harmonize pricing methodology. Limitations, of course, we need to discretize. It's the same as in Carr-Madan. The weights could be negative, so then you end up with spreads of baskets. So it's not, you know, like spread options are harder to price. So that one is a limitation of this approach. The Vanilla basket calls are all OTC, so there is limited market information. There is actually exchange of information between major banks that are active in this area. But anyway, so these are the most liquid options in a illiquid category of OTC. So you know, that is what we have to do for that. And some of the quantities could be infinite, but that's typically solvable with integration by parts. I'll show how. So a particular kind of option that was somewhat unsuspected is what I called standard dispersion option, which is similar to, if you remember, a term sheet initially of that dispersion option. It's the max, absolutely the sum of absolute performances of each of the assets, and then we have a call option on top. Instead, we could have a payoff on the norm. So it's a L1 norm. But instead, you know, we looked for mathematical reason, we looked at something closely related, which would be an option on the L2 norm, which would be the Euclidean norm. And so that is a little bit more theoretical. These options don't trade as such, but they are closely related to L1 dispersion options that practitioners trade. So that is the Quant Finance paper. And so there is actually a way of replicating these dispersion option payouts. The more general result is, you know, when the payoff of the multi-asset option, like a best of or worst of option, is absolutely homogeneous, then there is that also extension. So let me show what the result we found is. We have to use the solution is that for that problem is that the quantity of the option is going to be the inverse written transform of, you know, F second, but F second is now partial derivatives because we also have the variables X1 to XN. And so we have something that's a little unexpected that we have to, it's not just F second, it's F second, but we also have to apply an inverse radon transform to that function, which is a challenge in itself, but can be done. And so the proof is actually pretty simple. So remember, we're trying to replicate the multi-asset option to the left with a bunch of vanilla basket calls. We differentiate twice against K. And so we get that second derivative of a payoff against K. And then as we differentiate twice against K, and that's a motivation for keeping K as external to the integral, you know, we get a delta function of that basket minus K, basket performance minus K. And then we get, you know, everything else doesn't change. It's a multiple integral over Rn. It turns out that this is the definition of a radon transform of phi. And therefore phi is the inverse radon transform. So it's actually a very quick proof for the theoretical part. And the really hard part is how to make calculations and try to find some closed form formulas after that. So I just want to explain, because I didn't know anything about radon transform before I started to look into this direction. So it took me a while, and I used some really good textbook, but even finding a good textbook, it was not that easy. So there is it's a mathematical, well-known to mathematicians, especially those who are specialists in like Fourier transform theories and things like that. So how does it, where, how do we visualize that in two dimensions? So we have, let's say this is a setup where we have a, you know, table, and I guess I have to stick close to the mic. We have a table, and then there's a rectangular object on that table. And, you know, there's a, we are able to send a ray, which is this, I think there's an animation that I can do here. Oh,
There was supposed to be an animation. So we have a ray, so let's say it's an X-ray, that goes through the solid, and on the other side there's a detector that's going to say, okay, well, the ray went through solid for a duration of 2 seconds, let's say, or 2 microseconds, whatever it is, but, and therefore, you know, I'm reading 2 here. But if the ray goes where the solid is not, then the reading is 0. And then you do that in the orthogonal direction, okay? And so you get another reading of 1, because this is not as thick as the other side, where the solid is. Now you just like shut down the light. You don't know where the rectangle is, but you'd still have the information from the detectors. And what you do is that you back project. So you have some light behind each axis. And the light, if a detector is 0, then it goes completely. But otherwise, you know, there's a cache. And so here there's a cache of 2, or so there is a shaded rectangle that appears. And, you know, the light doesn't go through too much in that direction. You do that with an orthogonal light. And at the intersection, just using the information from the detectors earlier, you're able to reconstitute the position of the rectangle. And so that's how brain imaging works. Because, you know, you generalize this to going to in every direction, not just perpendicular directions. And so you have, you know, a patient here, and then you have a source of ray, again, an X-ray or something like this. And then there's a detector on the other side. You do that, you know, in every possible direction. So you go, you know, this is the head, and then you go, you know, rays like this, like that. And then, you know, what you recover is information about the sum of masses that each ray is going through. And you get some information that can be visualized in 2D like this. So it's a beautiful work of art. And then you apply the inverse radiant transform. And then you recover, you know, the magic of technology is you recover the actual slice of a patient brain without opening the patient's head. So we should all be very grateful to Mr. Radon, because it's all based on his mathematics here. So this is like from a book from 1976, Principles of Computer-Assisted Tomography. So, you know, this is how this magic is working, how we get. So the radon transform really is a fascinating tool, but then you've got like integral geometry coming up and so on. So before I don't know if I will have the time to go into more mathematical details, but I wanted to show some application of what we could replicate using those tools. And the first one it doesn't trade on markets, but it could. It's what we call a Mexican hat dispersion straddle in 2 dimensions. So the payoff function would be this kind of cone. And and the payoff function is 1 minus the exponential of the sum of asset performances squared. So it's a norm, exponential minus the norm. It's kind of almost like a Gaussian distribution. But this is a payoff, and this payoff can be at least thought of. It doesn't trade, but it's a little bit like a straddle, dispersion straddle. And it turns out that you can calculate in closed form the quantities of the basket call options you have to hold in order to replicate exactly this payoff. And it's a nice payoff that's kind of smooth and regular, so it lends itself well to this application. So I'm just not giving too many details here, but you know, the R value here is actually the norm of the weights, the basket weights. And then it involves also a special function, but you know, we haven't closed form the exact quantities of the basket calls. That way. And so what is this function phi? If we represent it in 3D, we get another hat, which would be maybe a clown's hat. and so we get that result that is shown here. Okay. And so the decomposition I have is that this payoff, which is a multi-asset payoff that cannot be separated into, you know, a bunch of single asset options, is, you know, this complex payoff can be replicated as a double integral of these vanilla basket calls times the quantity function that, you know, I didn't copy inside the integral, and we integrate that over all possibilities.
So what do you call capital F? I mean, economically, you say
it's a typo, it would be a small f, sorry, yeah.
No, but I'm just curious, why is that x1, x2 are the returns, right?
Yes.
Would you consider that payoff as economically being related to the dispersion of the two? I mean, if you're squaring the return,
because the dispersion is the absolute value of x1, right? And then the absolute plus the absolute value of x2. Right. So instead of taking absolute values, you take the squares,
And so it's a, what I call standard dispersion, which would be Euclidean dispersion as opposed to absolute value.
But I mean, if they both go up or one with one goes down, F's gonna have the same value, right? You just square it, right?
Yes, but so it's dispersion in the sense that it's related to the norm, and so you know that's what. But it's not exactly the same as a Cole dispersion Cole.
Yeah, I was gonna say like, I mean, shouldn't dispersion pay off, pay me more if let's say they do this, they go in opposite directions?
It could, but it depends if you're subtracting the mean or not. Here we're not subtracting the mean, so we are looking at just sum of absolute performances. Approximately, it's kind of a sum of absolute performances, but the R square. It is dispersion in the sense that it's Euclidean, you know, it's a norm-related type of option, but it's not the same exactly as the call on, you know, the Euclidean norm minus k. We have also formulas for proper dispersion calls. This is not a call option, it would be a sort of straddle.
Right, there's no strike here, of course, yeah.
So there is no strike. And,
okay, thank you.
Yeah, that's indeed a good question. Okay, so, but it's remarkable, this is a mathematical identity, and it's not obvious how you can break down this, you know, function of two variables into these basket call type of, you know, integrals. So we get some sort of solution here. We can do that with standard dispersion call. So, you know, instead of getting the sum of absolute performances, we get, you know, this norm, which is again is related. It's L2 norm rather than L1 norm. And then we can replicate that. So now the solution for that is actually a derivative of a delta function. And then the argument is actually an equation for a sphere. So what we end up having is, you know, we essentially integrate the basket calls over a sphere. But we have also, you know, a delta prime, so it's, you know, a little bit more exotic even than the other things. If we take expectations, you know, you would get, you know, something that's easier to put your finger on. But the thing is, okay, you can actually do integration by parts in order to obtain this formula here, which is, you know, you get essentially that the dispersion call is going to be the integral over the sphere of basket calls for all possible weights on the sphere. Okay, so there's essentially a constraint on the weights, which is that the sum of the squared weights is equal to one. And so you have a long position of one over pi in this basket calls and a short position of k over two pi in binary basket calls that pay $1 if the basket is performance greater than strike and zero otherwise. So just by doing a integration by parts, you actually get something a lot more tractable. And again, this is kind of an interesting mathematical identity, which is that a function on the norm, this particular function on the norm, can be decomposed into simpler type of, you know, you lose like the squares and doing all that. So you get, you know, other kinds of functions, and it's an identity. So, you know, it's perfect replication. So we got that also in 2D. So in 2D, we get into more funky stuff where, you know, we get actually a closed form formula that's not a delta prime, but it's worse because this is a non-converging integral. We have to do a so-called regularization. It's an integral on the disk. And so, you know, when the disk is at the edge, you get a value of zero. So, you know, it's a diverging integral in standard terms. But it's actually with our technique of regularization, we could get this as an integration by parts. We could get this kind of identity where the payoff is equal to a bunch of basket calls, binary basket calls, and what I call arrow de Breu basket calls. So we get a slightly funky payoff, but it's still a basket payoff. And so again, there's an identity here that works. Okay, and then I will just skip over that, but there is a standard dispersion put, which is, you know, actually turns out to be a headache because you would think that once you get the dispersion call, you would just get the dispersion put of using put call parity. But it turns out that the particular math here was kind of not that easy. And so there is a specific way of replicating. So in order to get put call parity, you have to use S being here the Euclidean norm. So that thing is actually not replicated with the same exact basket calls there. with replicated with zero stride basket pool. So anyway, we find a way of also doing a replication of the standard dispersion footprint. As I was kind of doing this research, I was all of a sudden sort of very surprised that, you know, the technique worked for coals, but it didn't seem to work for puts, you know, so you had to use an extra step in order to get there. The amazing part also is that we have a best of coal and put in two dimensions, so for two underlying asset replication. And again, the problem with even dimension in this approach is that we get these non-converging integrals, so we have to regularize them in order to get a meaningful result. But we get, you know, this kind of replication where the best of coal and on two underlying assets can be replicated with basket coals on two underlying assets, integrating over all possible possible weights on the basket, and the quantity is given by this formula. So again, we would need to do some integration by parts in order to get a little bit better traction, but it's possible, and it's certainly possible in higher dimensions, and it would look maybe a little bit better, but essentially there is replication as well. Now, if you don't like, you know, the way that this replication formulas work, you can just using some smoothing of the payoff function in order to recover something that would be a lot more tractable, which is what we obtained. The Mexican hat, and you probably would get a closed solution as well. So a lot of information going on, but I think it's kind of exciting. So the conclusion for this line of research is that unexpectedly somehow the European Carr-Madan formula can be generalized to multiple underlying assets. But then the math involved is, you know, a lot more difficult. It can be done. Major implication that I think, you know, was a surprise to many practitioners too, is that in principle, these multi-asset European options should be priced with the same model as the vanilla basket pools. So best of and worst of in vanilla basket pools, it should be in principle the same model you're happy is correct for basket pools. And this is also under penalty of arbitrage in principle. So it's a part of ongoing research effort to extend Carr-Madan, and it's also Breeden Mitzenberger to multi-asset options. And I think Breeden Transform is a really fascinating tool that has also potential. And you know, I'm looking even at applications related to artificial intelligence or machine learning and neural networks and things like that, that I guess goes even beyond quantitative finance. And so looking at discrete Carr-Madan in dimension one, there is actually a perfect hedge. It's an idea from Andrew. You can actually show that there is a version of Carr-Madan with an infinite series. It's an exact replication with an infinite series or an infinite integral of closed inputs. You could also use, of course, a finite number of closed inputs to get an imperfect hedging strategy and looking into that as well. And then, there are even higher dimensions for best of dispersion, look at numerical methods, risk analysis, so I'm doing an empirical study with Stefan Pepe and a couple of PhD students into that as well. And then here are some references. I have some more math if you really want it, but I guess it was already a lot of information. And I don't know how much time we still have. It's up to me. It's up to
we have no time for math at this point.
Okay, no more. I don't know. Maybe some questions first, and then.
Yeah, I think that'd be good. Okay. Any questions for?
There were already questions during the presentation.
I do have a question. So for the last slide, for the imperfect hedge, you have an infinite number of closed inputs in the series. And going back to first slides, we said that one of the proofs is just like expansion of data series, right?
Right.
So is it like this imperfect hedge, if you need an infinite series, is it connected to this like invert of the Radon transform? Because we know in some special cases, R minus one, okay, so we can recover the exact position, but in most cases we have kind of imperfect kind of reconstruction.
Right.
So these errors of doing this kind of reconstruction are kind of handled by this imperfect edge. Is it like something connected or?
Not exactly. It's more using a sort of Hilbert basis, and which would not be our orthogonal basis. So that's one challenge in terms of truncating for practical application. But in terms of, you know, if you do have an infinite number of poles and inputs as a series, a discrete, you know, calculably infinite, then you can get a perfect hedge using poles and inputs. And then the quantities would not be the second derivative, would be some integral, you know, something like that.
Now that's these are not connected. So how can we like guarantee that the iterative radon can give something like very accurate? How can we implement it? Because in some conditions we cannot guarantee we have imperfect R minus one, right?
So you're saying radon would not be accurate? If you're trying to discretize or something like that, or
yeah, I mean like for practical application, we would like to recall. I mean.
So it's not easy to discretize, and I think we had a discussion earlier also on like, you know, neural networks and convergence and things and so on. So I think it's kind of related to some of that, which is that there is a bit of a gap between finite, and as soon as you get to infinite, you know, and things look different in terms of a theoretical solution for infinite number of basis option, let's say, and finite number of one, as you try to get an optimal hedge. So you can discretize, and we did a little bit of that too. I got like some numerical integration sometimes using Mathematica, and I would get the identity as correct, right? But they would be, so they are doing a numerical integration, so it's in the end finite, but there are some kind of schemes that are deployed automatically to deal with this. Because I guess what you're referring to probably is that some of these, like, you know, this would be probably not something that Mathematica would be able to integrate. But if we, even just looking at the Mexican hat, that part can be integrated. There are some tricks involved, I guess, to just get the integral to work, but you can do some numerical integrations using that. So I don't know if I'm really answering the question, but in terms of strategies, if you want the perfect formula that's based on the delta prime or something like that, you can't really do numerical integration with that, right? But if you do integration by parts, then you actually get finite quantities of certain tractable things that depend on basket payoffs. And then for numerical integration of that wouldn't work very well. But so you have to do these integration by parts in order to get something more tractable numerically. Does that sort of answer your question?
So Jonathan, do you have a question?
Yeah. Two questions. The first one is why do we only use the out of money to calculate the fixed? And second one is if we only have like finite number of protocol, like when we do the replication, is Carr-Madan perform better or the Britten and Lisenberg?
So great question. So first one is why do we use out of any poles and put space? You don't have to. You can do Carr-Madan using on calls only, and then you would have in many calls and out of many calls. That's when I was setting S0 equal to zero. But it's popular, and for VIX you do that indeed with only out of many options, because they are more liquid. And the reason is they are less expensive in terms of dollars you have to put on the table to buy them. So they get more trading volume. And so that's a really practical reason. And then your second question is, you're having a finite number.
I'm choosing two method.
Right.
Replication.
So Carr-Madan will be continuous. So it's a theoretical hedge. So you always have to discretize. There are different discretization schemes. Some will be more accurate than others. If you want exact, then you have to do Carr-Madan and it's an integral. And if you're okay with some error, then you could do a simple discretization of Carr-Madan. You could look at something else, which is what I'm looking at too, which is finding the least square kind of regression hedge, you know, and try to minimize the hedging error. But then when you try to minimize the hedging error, the thing is, there is a zone that you really care about, even in one dimension. You don't think that the S&P is going to be going from zero to 100,000 within a month. You know? So then there are certain zone where you want to be very accurate. So maybe you want to discretize as accurately as you can for close to the money, and then not care too much about the wings. And the last thing is, but then, you know, if you're going to get really your market prices as such from the option market, then the strikes are decided for you. You know, the only discretization you can do, the points of discretization, the grid is going to be dictated by CDOE because, you know, they decide what the strikes are. So you don't necessarily have that much leeway in terms of discretization. There may be different schemes you can use, but the discretization point of the grid is going to be given by the market.
Thank you.
Question, yes.
I think another version could be to optimize using the kind of regression approach you suggested, but then using the other Peter Carr paper about Carr-Madan with the good deal range, you know, on the error term to say that you get a certain sharp ratio, guaranteed within a particular band.
Right.
So then you could say that, you know, obviously you want to replicate better, but choose the single, right, n-dimensional asset payoff option or whatever to that does the best job, and then find the next single one.
Right.
Rather than thinking about discretization, which is going to get a lot of what you might call collinearity and regression.
Right. Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know what you call it in this particular
context. Yeah. Yeah. I think that's fair. Yeah. The overlap or yeah. So, yeah. Yeah. Excellent. In fact, I'm sort of looking at that. And so you can even use like machine learning techniques to try to find also an optimal hedge. The question is what is optimal? And so if you only think in terms of payoff, which has a number of benefits, because you don't need to know the prices of vanilla biscuit calls, you know, and so on. But, you know, if you're looking really at payoffs, then again, the question is, well, what is the area you really want to be accurate? And and so when you do payoffs, you tend to have, you know, to be a bit agnostic and say, I just want to minimize the hedging error everywhere. But actually, in practice, you may actually want to.
But maybe not probably a square difference between the actual payoff and the replicate.
Yeah. So you know, a least square kind of approach. Yeah. But the thing is, okay, well, maybe you do that, but your numerical, you know, least square regression is going to really be bothered by a big discrepancy when the S&P is at 100,000, which you don't really care about, you know, in practice. But
not really, and you're going to knock
that off. Yeah. But there are all kinds of numerical, you know, or adaptations you have to do just to have, you know, to see really which area you really care about in terms of replication, which are. And the other problem, I guess, of doing some of these regression or, you know, discrete replication is, so in the zone you define, you're going to get the best possible hedge. But again, as soon as you get out, it could be completely crazy and wild outside. And if you, if the market ever gets there, you know, your hedge is going to be completely rubbish and you're going to potentially get really in big trouble. So, and the other fascinating thing about that is that we found, and we tend to find that the optimizer doesn't find the theoretical hedge, even for Carr-Madan, but it doesn't find F second. It finds something different. And so there's a little bit of mystery of, you know, which I'm trying to solve too, which is, why is it that the optimal hedge for a finite number isn't really, it will, I can show it will converge to Carr-Madan for an infinite number, but, you know, it can really get stuck, I think, in those local minimum and so on. And so we get, you know, different answers than we would otherwise expect from
the people. Well, what David is saying, let's say 10 options, right? And then you're looking like look at only payoffs, not prices. Take 10 options. Look at what their payoffs are in a bunch of S&P outcomes,
right?
And just regress. Well, if I have 1,000 observations, right? I've got payoff on my exotic, 10 payoffs on my 10 options, right? And I had that 1,000 times. So just do regression.
Yeah.
And see what the least square fit is.
Yeah, I would teach my class that and call it benchmark fit.
Right? Yeah. Okay, right.
Something like that. But I would say maybe regression is also you're throwing everything in.
Yeah.
What you're suggesting is a refinement is to say almost like a factor analysis on top of it. You have to choose a single existing contract.
Just one, like one.
Right. Okay. So you're doing like step by step. I think I forgot how it's named, but I think, yeah, there is a way to do these multiple regression, but step by step. And PCA is kind
so of. So I was trying to do this with spread options, for example. So if you gave me like one basket option, right, and then the vanilla options, and then asked me to choose of that category of available options, you know, what's the best single option?
Right.
Yeah, and then you say, okay, now giving that, now my, what's the next, if I could add a second one. So they're prioritized, because each time I add one, it adds transaction costs, which eventually exceed the benefit of the additional variable.
I have a spread option on A and X and Y, and you give me a bunch of single plain vanilla function call just on x and y.
Yeah, it's not enough because you have a correlation. That's why you need the, that's why you need the basket option. So
exactly.
Correlation.
Right. So Sebastian's plain vanillas are the basket of different weights. Those
right.
Those are your plain vanilla weights.
Right. Yeah. And but you could thing. You could vary the strikes too. You know, as especially if you're doing a finite selection or fix the weights where you know the market is. So the thing is. You may get a, you know, with just one contract, you will probably get a pretty crappy hedge. But yeah, you could analyze and how many do I need to add until I get to something that would be acceptable. What
so
we found for
10 or 20, then, if I remember.
Right. But actually 10 and 20 seems to be the sort of minimum you need to start to get to a reasonable, I guess, error, but it still would be maybe 5%, which, you know, on $1 million or $50,000. So it can still be substantial in terms of error versus the payoff. And if you really want to get really, really close, then you really need like hundreds of options. It's hard, at least for the multi-asset case. For the single asset, I think it's a good problem already, but yeah, I'm looking at, which is least square kind of regression type.
We've gone way over, but you can see there's a lot of KPIs of interest. So.
Right, yeah. So I don't know if, yeah, so thank you, Tony, for the question. I don't know if there's a question from the audience. Well, we should wrap up probably because we're a bit over time. So.
Yeah, the question would have popped up in the
screen. Oh, okay.
Is there something? No, I guess there's no.
Okay. So thank you very much. We appreciate you coming on.
Thank you for inviting me. Thank you.
That bag will be worth something someday.
Yeah.